Hello and welcome to Film Physicality. In this video, I'll just be talking about the movies that I watched in January and February of 2023. Let's get to it. So this past 2 months, I was pretty busy. Plus, I also traveled for vacation, so I didn't have that much time. So I didn't really watch many movies. So basically, that's why I'm doing 2 months in one video. But anyways, the first film that I watched is Mile. This one's from 2022, and it's directed by Parker Finn. Well, this one is his feature film directorial debut. After witnessing a bizarre traumatic incident involving a patient, Dr. Rose Carter starts experiencing frightening occurrences that she can't explain. As an overwhelming terror begins taking over her life, Rose must confront her troubling past in order to survive and escape her horrifying new reality. And so, I don't know, I feel like I'm supposed to hate this one, but I loved it so much. It's very reminiscent of the early 2000 films like The Ring, which is the type of horror I grew up with, while also taking inspiration from more recent films like It Follows, but then still adding some originality to the mix. It also has been a while since I've seen a movie with jump scares that actually work. I give this one a 4.5 out of 5. The next film that I watched is Resurrection. This one's also from 2022, and it's a mystery thriller with some horror elements that's directed by Andrew Simmons, which he also directed Nancy Please. So in this one, a woman's carefully constructed life gets turned upside down when an unwelcome shadow from her past returns, forcing her to confront the monster she's evaded for 2 decades. So I really liked this movie. I especially loved the atmosphere of the movie and also the acting, which Rebecca Hall and Tim Roth give amazing performances. I speak more about this one on my video where I rank the Shudder movies that I own. I'll link that up here. I give this one a 3.5 out of 5. The next one I watched is God's Crooked Lines. This is from 2022 and it's a Netflix original Spanish mystery thriller, and it's directed by Oriol Paulo, who also directed The Invisible Guest, which is a very good movie. Private investigator Alice checks into a psychiatric hospital to collect evidence for a case she's working on, the death of an inmate under ambiguous circumstances. The reality she faces in her confinement exceeds her expectations and casts doubt on her own sanity. And so, even though it's a pretty long movie, it has pretty good pacing, while still maintaining the mystery going out throughout the film. I really love a good plot twist, and this one really delivers plot twist over plot twist. Some are predictable but still fun, while others just completely take you by surprise. I give this one a 4.5 out of 5. The next film that I watched is Red Rocket. This one's from 2021 and it's directed by Sean Baker, who he also directed The Florida Project and Tangerine, which are also both very good movies. Being back home in small town Texas after burning bridges and flaming out all over Los Angeles, a hustler, operator, and charismatic con man quickly learns that no one wants him back. When he meets a teenager working at a local donut shop, he sees his ticket back to the big time. So this one was pretty good. It has very down-to-earth characters. I do love how Sean Baker portrays real-life issues in such a believable way. I also love the performance from Simon Rex, where you feel like you really hate the character, which I guess is kind of the point of the movie. But you also just have a lot of fun watching him. It probably might have been about 30 minutes too long, though. I give this one a 4 out of 5. The next one I watched is I Came By. This is from 2022, and it's a Netflix original thriller directed by Babak Anvari, who also directed Under the Shadow. A rebellious young graffiti artist targets the home of the wealthy elite, but discovers a shocking secret that leads him on a journey endangering himself and those closest to him. So this one has a pretty good premise, although it might have been inspired a bit by Don't Breathe. The film was just okay overall, a bit better than I expected. It changes from character to character without one soul star, which was pretty interesting, but then not much happens with each one. Everyone also makes very, very stupid decisions on this, although everyone then gets a pretty realistic consequence for their decisions or actions. I give this one a 3 out of 5. The next one is a classic horror story. This is from 2021, and it's a Netflix original Italian horror, which is directed by Robert DeFeo and Stripoli, which I'm not sure if I'm saying right. On this one, strangers traveling in southern Italy become stranded in the woods, where they must fight desperately to get out alive. And so it is mostly a folk horror, but done pretty differently. It bothers from and pays homage to a lot of different horror movies and styles. I loved how one of the guys is a horror movie fan and he compares what is happening to them to a classic horror movie, just like the title. The character reactions to what is happening don't really seem very believable in some situations. It has some plot twists, which the first plot twist is very predictable, but after that, not at all, and I really loved the third act. I give this one a 4 out of 5. The next film that I watched is I'm Thinking of Ending Things. This is a Netflix original drama horror directed by Charlie Kaufman, who also directed Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind and Adaptation. Full of misgivings, a young woman travels with her new boyfriend to his parents' secluded farm. She slowly then starts to question everything she thought she knew about him and herself. So this one is probably not for everyone. It is very slow, lingering on the same conversation subjects for long periods of time. But it's the anomalies during and in between these conversations that create a mystery that keep you intrigued throughout the whole film, which also lead to a very good reveal at the end, all while leaving you with a feeling of dread that then have you watching some lighthearted animated episodes afterwards just to eliminate that feeling. I give this one a 4 out of 5. The next one I watched is also a Netflix original, and that's Incantation. This one's from 2022, and it's a Taiwanese found footage horror film that's directed by Kevin Koh. 6 years ago, a woman is cursed after breaking a religious taboo. Now, she must protect her daughter from the consequences of her actions. So I found it interesting how the main character talks to the viewer or whoever found the footage, and then she's the one that shows you the clips in the movie, like if she did the edits for the viewer. And this dynamic also plays out at the end. It has some very creepy scenes. The main character also has to make some difficult decisions regarding her daughter that are very hard to watch. And just what's happening to her daughter throughout the film is very difficult to watch, and it's also very disturbing if you ask me. Although then the found footage is not very believable and sometimes, with some pretty impossible shots, and then of course the added music score as well. Which is kind of hard to believe that the main character added a music score when editing her video. It might also have a bit much unnecessary dialogue, making the film probably longer than it should have been. I give this one a 3 out of 5. The next film that I watched is Two Witches. This is from 2022, and it's a low-budget horror film directed by Pierre Tsigaridis, which I'm probably saying that wrong. And this is his feature film directorial debut.
On this one, an aging malevolent witch intercedes in the lives of two young women. And so I liked that even though this is modern, it feels like an older 70 movie, taken from Sam Raimi and then Italian horrors as well. It was also pretty interesting how it was like two anthology stories, but also not really since both were a bit connected. You can notice the low budget in some scenes, but really not too much to take away from it. It does then rely too much on cheap jump scares though. The music score too, in my opinion, was kind of all over the place, being very loud in scenes that didn't call for it, and just making it feel out of place.
I give this one a 2.5 out of 5. The next one I watched is True Romance, since I got this nice Arrow release. But anyways, this one's from 1993, and it's written by Quentin Tarantino, but directed by Tony Scott, who also directed Top Gun, Man on Fire, Enemy of the State, and others.
In Detroit, a lonely pop culture geek marries a call girl, steals cocaine from her pimp, and tries to sell it in Hollywood. Meanwhile, the owners of the cocaine, the mob, track them down in an attempt to reclaim it. So, I love all Tarantino films, but this is my first time watching this. And even though it's not directed by him, it definitely feels like a Tarantino film. And it was just so, so good. The scenes were all very fun, with just the right amount of suspense, action, and comedy. The film also has an amazing cast, with big names doing small roles, which was also very fun to see. And yeah, not really much else to say, just a very, very fun movie.
I give this one a 4.5 out of 5. The next one I watched is The Hangover. This is because we were traveling to Las Vegas. But anyways, this is from 2009, and it's directed by Todd Phillips, who also directed Joker, War Dogs, Road Trip, and some others.
Three buddies wake up from a bachelor party in Las Vegas, with no memory of the previous night and the bachelor missing. Now, they must find their friend before the wedding. And yeah, not much to say, this is one that is just overall a lot of fun. Most of the jokes work, and I think it's probably because even the premise on its own is just hilarious.
I give this one a 3.5 out of 5. The next one that I watched is Terrifier, since I want to watch the second one and I hadn't seen this one. But anyways, this one's from 2016 and it's a horror slasher that's directed by Damien Leone.
On this one, a crazy clown stalks and tries to kill three women in a wretched old apartment building on a Halloween night. So this is definitely low budget, and you can tell, but also it's not as bad as I expected. The acting is also not so great, and then all the characters make really dumb decisions, which I know is usually a normal thing in horror, but in this one it's just an every single decision. But then again, overall, I did end up having a lot of fun with it.
I give this one a 2.5 out of 5. The next one I watched is The Menu. This is from 2022, and it's a horror thriller directed by Mark Mylod.
A young couple travels to a remote island to eat at an exclusive restaurant where the chef has prepared a lavish menu with some shocking surprises. Nicholas Holt's character on this was a lot of fun, and then of course Anya Taylor-Joy and Ralph Fiennes did a great job as well. It is a bit in your face with the social criticism, but also at the same time it doesn't take itself too seriously, which I really liked. Overall, it's just a pretty original and fun movie.
I give this one a 3.5 out of 5. The next one I watched is Reservoir Dogs. This is from 1992, and I got this nice steelbook of it. I featured this steelbook on my previous video, which I can link up here. But anyways, this one's from 1992, and it's a crime thriller, and it's actually the first film that was directed by Quentin Tarantino.
Six criminals are hired to carry out a robbery. The heist is then ambushed by the police, and the gang are forced to shoot their way out. At their rendezvous, the survivors realize that they were set up, and so now they need to find the traitor between them. So this is a rewatch for me, and I came to appreciate it more on this watch than I did on the first one. Even with the short runtime, every character has something fun to bring to the table, and it has some great and very memorable scenes, with my favorite character being Mr. Pink, played by Steve Buscemi. It might be one of my least favorite Tarantino films, but that's not saying much since I do love all of them.
I give this one a 4.5 out of 5. The next film is then Barbarian. This is from 2022, and it's a very well-known horror movie, and it's directed by Zach Cregger, who has acted in a few movies, and then he also directed two other lesser-known movies before this one.
And so, being pretty vague as to not include spoilers, a woman staying at an Airbnb discovers that the house she has rented is not what it seems. And so, in my opinion, this movie definitely lived up to the hype. I had so much fun with it, I love the mystery elements too, and then how it just goes completely bonkers later on. And I especially love Justin Long's character and performance.
I give this one a 4.5 out of 5. The next film that I watched is After Yang. This is from 2021, and it's a science fiction drama directed by Kogo Nada, who also directed Columbus.
When his young daughter's beloved companion, an android named Yang, malfunctions, Jake now searches for a way to repair it. And in the process, Jake discovers the life that has been passing before him as he reconnects with his wife and his daughter. And so the film has great mystery elements, but unfortunately they don't really lead to anything exciting. The movie is also a bit slow and feels longer than it actually is, but it is still a very original, well-acted, and moving film.
I give this one a 3.5 out of 5. The next one I watched is Halloween Ends, and I got this nice Walmart exclusive slipcover. Anyways, this one's from 2022, and it's directed by David Gordon Green, who also directed the other two Halloween on the reboot trilogy, and also directed Pineapple Express and a few others.
4 years after her last encounter with mass killer Michael Myers, Laurie Strode is living with her granddaughter. Then, when a young man stands accused of murdering a boy that he was babysitting, it ignites a cascade of violence and terror that forces Laurie to confront the evil she can't control. So of course, this is the third entry in the Halloween reboot, but this one wasn't very well received, and was actually received worse than Halloween Kills. And while I didn't exactly love it, I also didn't hate it. I think the main issue with this one is that you expect an epic conclusion to the Halloween saga, and in turn, to Michael Myers and Laurie's story, and it definitely doesn't deliver on that. Instead, it goes in a very different direction to all the others. Maybe if the movie had a different name and wasn't tied to the Halloween story, maybe it would have been received better.
I give this one a 2.5 out of 5. The next film that I watched is Strange World. This is from 2022, and it's a Disney animated movie directed by Don Hall, which he co-directed Big Hero 6 and Raya the Last Dragon.
Three generations of a legendary family of explorers will find themselves in an uncharted land with strange creatures. If they want to survive from the numerous dangers, they must bridge their differences and work together. And so, not much to say on this one, really. It at least had good animation and was somewhat enjoyable, but then it just felt very generic, predictable, and with no real memorable scenes.
I give this one a 2 out of 5. The next I watched is Nanny. This one's from 2022, and it's an Amazon original drama horror directed by Nikayatu Jusu, which I'm probably saying wrong, and this is his feature film directorial debut.
An African woman hopes her new job as a nanny will help bring her son to the United States. However, when a violent present begins to invade both her dreams and reality, it threatens to destroy everything she's fought for. So this one was not too bad. It had great performances. But to me, it just mostly felt boring and repetitive, like it kept dangling or circulating around the same things for too long.
I give this one a 2.5 out of 5. The next film that I watched is Oxygen. This one's from 2021, and it's a Netflix original sci-fi directed by Alexandre Aja, who also directed Crawl, the remake for The Hills Have Eyes, and Horns, and some more.
On this one, a woman wakes up in a cryogenic chamber with no recollection of how she got there. And now she must find a way out before running out of oxygen. And so the first act on this one is very intriguing and keeps you interested. It then gets very slow on the second half, but then on the third act it has a great reveal that changes the whole perspective of the movie. It's overall a pretty solid film in my opinion.
I give this one a 3 out of 5. The next movie that I then watched is Fences. This is from 2016, and it's a drama directed by and starring Denzel Washington, along with Viola Davis as well.
A working-class African-American father tries to raise his family in the 1950s, while coming to terms with the events of his life and how his life turned out. And so the performances from both Denzel Washington and Viola Davis are just phenomenal. It doesn't really have that much else going for it, though. It is emotional, but I thought it to be a somewhat underwhelming story overall. I guess I just expected more. But in my opinion, the movie is worth watching just because of the acting.
I give this one a 3.5 out of 5. The next film that I watched is Violent Night. This is from 2022, and it's a Christmas action comedy directed by Tommy Wirkola, who also directed What Happened to Monday, Hansel and Gretel Witch Hunters, The Trip, and some others.
When a group of mercenaries attack the estate of a wealthy family, Santa Claus must now step in to save the day and Christmas. And so, when the movie doesn't take itself too seriously, it has a lot of good comedy and just ridiculous fun overall, which is what you probably expect from this film. But then it has too many parts in between where it just takes itself too seriously, and it ends up dragging.
I give this one a 3 out of 5. The next movie I watched is Black Panther Wakanda Forever. This is from 2022, and it's of course the sequel to the first Black Panther movie. It's directed by Ryan Coogler, who also directed the first Black Panther and the first Creed.
On this one, the people of Wakanda fight to protect their home from intervening world powers as they mourn and deal with the death of King T'Challa. This is a very emotional follow-up to the first Black Panther. The emotional scenes do work very well, and it does have a lot of great cinematography. But in my opinion, the story and action sequences just leave a lot to be desired.
I give this one a 3 out of 5. The next is Catch Me If You Can. This is from 2002. And it's a crime thriller directed by Steven Spielberg, who of course directed Jurassic Park, Indiana Jones, E.T., Jaws, Ready Player One, and a lot of others.
Barely 21 yet, Frank is a skilled forger who has passed as a doctor, a lawyer, and a pilot. FBI agent Carl then becomes obsessed with tracking down the con man, who only revels in the pursuit. So this has a great cast, including Leonardo DiCaprio, Tom Hanks, Christopher Walken, and others, even including a small role by Jennifer Garner. And they all gave great performances, especially Leonardo DiCaprio. I think he played that role very well and was just a lot of fun to watch. And yeah, the whole movie was just a clever cat and mouse crime movie that was just a lot of fun.
I give this one a 4 out of 5. The next movie that I watched is Friday the 13th Part 3. This is from 1982, and it's the third sequel to Friday the 13th, and it's directed by Steve Miner, who also directed the second part and H2O, along with also Lake Placid and House.
On this one, of course, just like the other ones, Jason stalks a group of friends who just arrived to spend a weekend at a cabin near Crystal Lake. So this one was 3D at the time, and I'm sorry, but I just hate 3D movies that are aware that they are 3D. The ones where like everything's very obviously coming out to the screen. I don't know, I just think it really throws you off. I wish that was the only thing wrong with it, though. Where the previous two movies are still very cheesy, they're also very fun and decent movies. This one just felt very, very lazy and just had way too many face-palming moments.
I give this one a 1 out of 5. The next film that I then watched is The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou. This one's from 2004, and it's a drama comedy directed by Wes Anderson, who also directed The Grand Budapest Hotel and The French Dispatch.
With a plan to exact revenge on a mythical shark that killed his partner, oceanographer Steve Zissou rallies a crew that includes his strange wife, a journalist, and a man who may or may not be his son. So this has some good comedy and originality, but at the same time its constant dry jokes and monotonous dialogue just end up making it boring for the most part. I don't know though, it seemed right up my alley at first, so I might have to revisit this one in the future. Maybe I just wasn't in the right mood.
I give this one a 2 out of 5. Okay, and that's it for the movies that I watched this past 2 months. If you did watch till the end, thank you. And if you did like this video, give me a thumbs up. And remember to subscribe, and I'll see you on the next one.